session in collaboration with Citizen Matters on rooftop solar implementation. Some ground rules for the session. Please do keep your audio on mute and post your queries on the chat window, which can be taken at the end of the session. Please raise your hand when you wish to speak. Bangalore is among the first cities to be electrified in India, but the power generation seems to be stuck in the past, not keeping up with the mega city it is turning out to be. So more and more apartments are going in for renewable energy rather than depend on BESCOM supply, unreliable at that. Today we have on our panel some of these BAF members who have gone ahead and taken the leap and implemented rooftop solar in their respective complexes. We start with Mr. Satish Mallya, who is the General Secretary of Century Saras, President of BAF North Cluster, North One Cluster, and actively involved in COVID task force team of BBMP Yelahanka Zone during the pandemic. We have the second speaker, Mr. Vishnu Guttapalli, President of Trifecta Starlight Apartments, Secretary of BAF Whitefield 1 and 2 Clusters. We have the third speaker is Mr. Nikhil Grover, who has served in various capacities as the MC of Brigade Petunia, one of the early implementers of solar. He is from BAF Banshankari Cluster. Then we have Mr. Harsha Kuntur, who happens to be a member of BAF North One Cluster. He wears a double hat as a member and a MD of EcoSoch Solar. And then we have Mr. Sripan Saurabh, who is an engineering manager at UL India Private Limited, who has authored two technical papers, degradation of analysis of crystalline PV modules and thin film modules in Indian conditions. He is a member of 28 BIS committees, which are engaged in developing standards for the Indian subcontinent. He's a part of the core technical team of MNRE, which is the Ministry of New and Renewable Energy. And then we have Mrs. Meera K, who is a co-founder and editor of Citizen Matters, and Ekta Savant, engagement lead at Citizen Matters. And Shankar Swaminathan, Vice President of BAF, and Vikram doesn't need much of intro, General Secretary of BAF. So all to you, Meera.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, everybody, for joining us on a Saturday evening. I'm Meera from Citizen Matters. So in general, in cities especially, our power consumption have only been increasing. In fact, in Bangalore, we are now seeing ACs are getting very common. And a large section of, you know, those who are well-to-do have gazillion gadgets on all the time. And it's obvious that we need to become much more sustainable in terms of our consumption as well as production. And solar is a pretty obvious option, especially for Bangalore, because we have enough sunshine here. Now, solar energy is not a new thing. It's probably been around for over 100 plus years. And solar PV cells are one of the best ways to generate renewable energy. But till recently, it was one of those things that only really committed eco nuts with money to spare went ahead and installed in their homes, because the return on investment just did not make sense, right? But in the last 10 years, it's been a massive change. The solar panel costs have dropped drastically, and the solar panel efficiency have also really increased a lot. And this has now meant that solar electric is a very viable option. And in the case of apartments, you know, most of us have spaces in our terraces which can be used to install the plant, and it can handle the common area load. After all, you know, that's one of the largest items in our maintenance budget. And in the last few years, there's been a lot of interest in Bangalore matched by action on the ground. So we see all these apartments who have gone ahead and installed the plants. And we're very happy to have the MC members from some of those apartments here today. And many more apartments are now considering it, and they have questions as they dive, you know, deeper into the project implementation. And but there are also some worries on the regulatory front. Is there going to be a bottleneck? What do we need to do to ensure that it remains a viable, worthwhile option for our home energy needs? So a lot of work ahead, and we hope you've been through the three articles recently that we had published on Citizen Matters. We took stock about the current situation. We had some guides on implementing solar and a detailed note on how Century Saras has gone ahead and implemented it. Now, Sandhya will be, you know, moderating today, and she has a few questions to the panelists. And so please post your questions as we go along on the chat window, and Ekta, my colleague, will be looking out for them. So back to Sandhya.
Thank you, Meera. Sati is our first speaker. Today is a special day for you people. You had the inauguration of your solar plant. So how did it go?
Yeah, good evening, everybody. Thanks for inviting me. In fact, it was a good program because we had our MLA, local MLA, who's incidentally a BDA chairman, who has come in time and talked about much about solar, and two assurance he has given us. One is we talked about, in fact, our joint secretary Vidya was there. She was in her speech were talking about the regulation. So what he said is, please come over and meet our engineers in BDA. And his level, being a political secretary to CM, whatever way he can help, he will do it in a policy level to give instruction to the power ministry. So that is one. Second thing, he also told us as a Century Saras to be a promoter of this among other apartments in Yelahanka. And he said whenever he goes for any function in Yelahanka, he's going to promote solar energy. So these are two takeaway from the function. And this function all is all about because we got UL validation and certification. Which is, we are the only one of the, I think we are the one, only the one apartment in India was gone for this UL process. So I think that is the one of the major thing we have done it, other than what gone for a higher specification for solar panel as well as micro inverters. So this UL certification, what we meant is that just to ensure that the suppliers or the EPC vendor is doing the right process for installation and design and everything. So this we thought, because any project for the for a 20-year horizon, we just want to install and forget. Maybe we may not be there for the to complete this 25 years in our lifetime, but it should ensure that quality process is done. And we felt it's UL is one of the good third-party agency to do this. So we are happy that we are the only apartment to do so. In the process, we ensure that the coming MC or managing committee in our community are sure that we have done the right process and right application to get the solar energy. This is what I want to say now, right now. I think it was a good function.
Thank you, Satish. Meera, can you show the video? I think you have a video for us to share.
Yeah. Second.
Century Saras, being a large community of 128 apartments, the electricity cost for the common amenities were quite high, almost 80K per month. Hence, we decided to go for a rooftop solar project, considering its benefits, both economically as well as environmental benefits. Hence, we installed a rooftop solar project plant of 49.7 kWp, and we saved 3 lakhs in just 6 months' time, that is 50K per month. And the payback period is just 4 years' time approximately. And we can reap the benefits for the next 25 years without any much significant maintenance costs.
We at Century Saras gone for the latest technology with REC Singapore panel. It's the only company gives 25 years of product and performance warranty. We also gone with Enphase for our micro inverters, considering the safety aspect of our rooftop. We have successfully completed the verification, inspection, and compliance for this solar project by Underwriters Laboratories. We are very thankful to Solar Square to achieve this feat, having a world-class project. We are the only apartment in Bangalore to achieve this.
Now, this project saves about 54 tons of carbon emission for the environment. This initiative is equivalent to creation of one Lal Bagh every year for Bangalore, or about planting of 1,300 trees every year.
Over to you, Sandhya.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you, Satish. So my first question is to Nikhil. Nikhil, being you guys were the first ones to sort of go in for solar implementation, rooftop solar implementation. Being part of an association, I'm sure you had a lot of challenges, especially when it comes to creating an asset in an apartment complex. So how did you people go about doing it? Can you share your experiences?
Hi, everyone. I'm from Brigade Petunia. We went in for the solar project in the year 2018, August. And that is our program, you know, process in September 2017. So we started off by visiting various, you know, schools and colleges projects which had installed solar, because we really didn't have any, you know, precedent earlier. We were not aware of any apartments which had really gone in for solar. So what we noticed is there were many projects which did not have great quality panels, and they were not being maintained. So we got a rough idea over 3 months, and then we presented it to our in our EGM to all our members, and we got a great response. Actually, while we presented the issues regarding environmental benefits, it was really a question of explaining to everyone that it's not only about the environmental benefits, but also about we getting a higher return on investment compared to, investing in FD. So definitely solar has higher returns, IRR on the project tends to be higher than, 16 to 20%, depending on whether you go in for subsidies or whether you don't get subsidies. So it is definitely a much better project than, keeping the money in FDs. So on explaining these factors to the residents, it was easy to, get the approval, but we faced certain challenges because our vendors tended to back out, and then we had to, redo the entire process and go in for another vendor. So we had a, issue in terms of getting the approvals from BESCOM. It was really slow, and due to elections, we had a lot of delays. But overall, once the plant was installed, we have not faced a single issue till date. And it's been 2.5 years, and we are pretty happy with the performance of our plant. And we're getting more than 4.3 units generation per day, which is fantastic, frankly. So IRR returns tend to be good on solar projects, and that's what I would like to say.
Thank you, Nikhil. And how has the maintenance been? Any challenges there?
Absolutely no problems. I mean, once a year we face a problem with few panels. Sometimes you have issues with painting, when we went in for a painting across our apartment, the painters did not take some precautions, and some of the panels the efficiency went down. So apart from that, we have not faced a single issue with our solar edge inverters till date.
Okay. Thank you. The next question is to Vishnu. Vishnu, cost is an impediment when we undertake such a large-scale project, which involves a lot of lot of processes as well, not only on cost. So can you just give us an overview on how this one works in terms of BESCOM, the net metering or the gross metering? And
sure, Sandhya. So thanks for inviting. So I would just take a few minutes to explain the net metering and gross metering concept. So it's fairly simple. So the net metering, how it works is when the panels are connected, they generate the electricity. So what you do is when you're generating surplus, other than first you consume within your apartment common areas, then you export the surplus to the BESCOM, and you are basically billed for the net units that you have consumed after import and export calculation is done, right? And after all this, if we are generating surplus, depending upon the, let's say, the subsidy or with subsidy or without subsidy, the tariff would be, you know, starting from like, you know, it can go from 2 rupee 32 paisa to 3 rupee 99 paisa. That's how the net metering works. So it's actually a net calculation of what you generate versus what you consume and the actual net of it. The gross metering is not so advantageous commercially because of the fact that you generate and you're directly connecting and exporting to the grid and you get paid at this rate, whereas whatever you are consuming from the grid, let's say from BESCOM, you're paying for it. So in simple terms, in this scenario, you're paying, let's say, 8.8 rupees per unit to BESCOM, and you are getting, let's say, 2.3 rupees or maybe maximum 4 rupees for the units that you're generating. So that won't work out financially. So some simple return on investment calculations for people, in interest of the people. So I've taken a rough estimation of, like, let's say 50 kWp site is the cost of project is, you know, will be 25 lakhs. That is, it can be slightly less, slightly more, depending upon which panels you choose, which inverters you choose, if you have an elevation, no elevation, or things like that. So roughly, if you're considering that. So with the calculation that currently we are paying 8.8 and, you know, with an increment that the tariff increases 3% every year, now we are seeing the sharp increase in the, let's say, the tariff. So if you invest 25 lakhs, you are going to break even in the fifth year of your investment, right? And then you continue to generate electricity and you continue to make money. On one hand, you're you know, making the planet greener and less emissions, etc. But at the end of the day, after 20, 25 years, you are, you know, saving enough money and your investment is worth it. So that's the, you know, break-even chart. So in the fifth year, you'll typically break even and then you keep making the profits up to 25th year. When it comes to gross metering, the problem is if you're considering at 3 rupees as a tariff that we are paying, the break-even only happens in the, let's say, in the 12th year, right? So with that, what happens is, in general, people would be put off to go for gross metering. So that's one other aspect that I want to speak on, the policy aspect or how it's going to work. So if gross metering is enforced right now, then that would be a big challenge. So that's, I mean, this is the chart for gross metering. So one point on the policy that I wanted to say is there is a draft regulation by the Government of India, so which has been notified to states. So that's one controversial point, in that is up to 10 kilowatts or kWp only is allowed for net metering, and anything above is gross metering, right? So, but whereas if we take many apartments, so a simple calculation is if you are considering 1 lakh rupees as a common area electricity bill, you would need average of 100 kWp installed capacity, right? So there are big apartments, I know, like, they require 300 kWp, 500 kWp and more. So they would be at disadvantage if this policy comes into effect. But Karnataka luckily has not yet issued anything yet, but from BF side, we are representing to BESCOM as well as KERC, our energy secretary, to make some headway into this policy. And some examples that I can say is, Telangana allows net metering up to 1000 kWp as per their latest policy. Gujarat in their 2021 policy says that, you know, they allow net metering up to 1000 kWp, and it gets even better. It allows the leasing of rooftop solar, which is effectively paving way for OPEX model. Right? So that the OPEX policy is not there, unfortunately, in Karnataka. So that's one bottleneck with respect to the net metering versus gross metering. I would say when the policy is available, make hay, or, you know, and then right now, the you know, even if you do a PPA up till March 31st, you can still get net metering, right? So I would advise or encourage everyone to go for the net metering. Hope that answers.
Yes, thank you, Vishnu. Next question is to Vikram. Vikram, BAT had a role to play in this large-scale implementation adoption of solar in apartment complexes. Can you take us through how that came about?
Yeah, I think, glad to see, lot of member representatives who have gone through the implementation in the last couple of years, including Nikhil. Very glad to see him because I think, like Nikhil recounted a little bit of his story, they were the first ones pretty much in Bangalore to take a dip in the deep end of the pool. They actually compared with non-residential installations to come up with their sort of design and philosophy on moving forward. So yeah, Nikhil, thanks for being there. Thanks for being the early adopter. So I think Nikhil, Brigade Petunia, and then there was a group of core group of representatives from BAF, Srikant, our ex-general secretary, Kazi, who came in also as an expert, who put together a lot of thinking and analysis on making a very compelling, but yet a very simple case for apartment associations to go and do the rooftop installation. A lot of work also, this is in 2018, which also roughly coincided with the time when Nikhil spoke about their installation itself. I think in October of 2018, the first white paper was published as part of the BAF knowledge base. This was preceded by a lot of work which was done along with the BESCOM as well. At that point of time, Ms. Shikha was the MD over there. She was very supportive and encouraging. A lot of process constraints which was there at that point of time in approval of the solar captive solar systems, power purchase agreement approvals, etc., were simplified because of the work done by BAF and a group of member associations, including actually creating a specific portal for application of rooftop solar systems. BAF team was present, which at that point of time was inaugurated, I think, by the then Chief Minister, Mr. H.D. Kumaraswamy. So I think, yes, BAF played a very important role in pushing forward. One, I think a lot of process challenges which were at that point of time, helping simplify the process challenges which was there at that point of time. BESCOM also supported that initiative and creating a very simple knowledge pieces for members to learn from without too much of complication, because at the end of the day, a topic like rooftop solar is a fairly technical topic, right? And I must also recognize the role played by many market players, including people like Harsha from EcoSoch. I think there were about five or six brand leaders who came together. We created a specific focus group, a rooftop solar focus group, which was a WhatsApp group, which is still a very thriving WhatsApp group. So that, I think, created an engagement channel, a communication channel, that group. There was wisdom and knowledge and white papers which got created. In fact, Vishnu has himself put together a version 2 of that. I think sometime in 2020, January 2020, he authored a version 2 of that white paper with a lot more additional knowledge which got created, and I think a lot of members who went in for the installation between late 2018 to now, I think, benefited a lot by their, one, being a lot of early adopters who gave them the confidence, second, there being the knowledge and wisdom which was very easy to adopt and consume, plus the fact that I think the process had been very, very simplified, so that not every individual apartment didn't have to discover that and risk the process discovery on their own, like how some of the early adopters had to be done. Right? So I think at this point of time, my estimate would be that there are at least about 60-70 of our member apartments who have already had installations. I don't know, I think Harsha and people like them might have a better estimate, but my estimate is that I think within BAF, we might have at least 60-70 apartments which already have captive installations. We have had my apartment ourselves. I think we took simply, if I'm not mistaken, about 3 months to just do all the analysis, get the general body approval, our team visited three member apartments, including Nikhil's apartment. They just got a quick confidence, looked at the knowledge base paper, and contacted a bunch of EPCs and vendors. And within, I think, the 5th to 6th month, we had started in about 2019 March. The process by November we were up and running. Right, so we have now just completed 1 year, a little over 1 year of production. So yes, I think BAF had played a very important role, but I think that is definitely in collaboration with early adopter members and market players, and with support from BESCOM as well. Like Vishnu rightly mentioned, I think there's a current challenge with the new guideline on the net metering, which has come about, which will disincentivize a lot of apartments to go for that. We are still working at our end to see how we can influence a change in that policy. That is work in progress. But like Vishnu mentioned, while we have the current policy till March 31st, I think it might be a good opportunity for any interested members to move forward, apartments to move forward, because there's not too much of discovery to be done, too much risk to be taken. It's very clearly laid out, at least currently. Over to you, Sandhya.
Thank you, Vikram. Next question is to Harsha. Harsha, policies keep changing. Electricity is a concurrent subject. And center is now coming out with a policy asking states to implement it. I think that has a bearing in how the apartments see whether it will be cost effective going forward. What do you think, how has this played? And do you see more challenges in the future?
Yeah, thanks, and thanks for the question. And first, I actually would like to thank BAF. I've been working with BAF actually in the last three years, I mean, ever since we were connected on the policy. And I'll tell you this, that the even 3 years ago, the implementation from BESCOM was really bad. I mean, you know, in terms of whether getting PPAs done or billings done, there were a lot of issues, So BAF actually, Vikram, Nagaraj Rao sir, Muralidhar Rao sir, Vidya, Arun, Shankarji. I mean, a lot of them had actually early days. I remember Srikant. I mean, a lot of people actually were involved in the initial days to actually go to the BESCOM, talk to them, convince them about the policy. Nikhil, of course, was there, being a first apartment to have implemented this. A lot of things got streamlined with BESCOM. And, it's still work in progress for the, as far as the BESCOM is concerned in terms of implementation. Unfortunately, you have these in between, you get these regulatory policies changes that keep coming in, that actually impact the rooftop policy. And every year, and I'll just want to give the history behind this, for last 5 years, there's never been a year where the policy continued beyond March 31st. Every year, the March 31st, the policy ends. And since BAF is there, and BAF was giving a representation that, policy should continue for the next year. And then that's how it has been. And then after 4 months, the new policy comes into picture, right? This that's been a standard procedure with BESCOM and KERC so far. There always been one thing which I know and I've seen and experienced firsthand is that both KERC and BESCOM have been very reciprocative to BAF in a very, very good way, right? Many things actually have started moving once the BAF got involved. And I think going forward, I think Vishnu and Satish and, they have been working hard to actually, and others as well, Shankarji, working hard to get the BESCOM and KERC to again look at this policy that of about 10 kilowatt going with cross metering. To at least give an exemption for the apartments. And I'm actually bullish that they might actually agree. Only two things on that I want to say is that I had a discussion with the BESCOM officials early this week. BESCOM has actually been, they are saying, although they would like to promote, as a ESCOM, they feel that solar is a threat to them. And they want to give their proposal to KERC as a gross metering only for including apartments as well as industries and other buildings about 10 kilowatt. But the buck stops at KERC for us, and of course the energy secretary for us, who might actually have some influence in the KERC. But you know, we hope, and KERC has been very reciprocative, and they've always been want to ensure that for the end consumers, maybe industries, the losses for them, they see that the loss of revenue is more from the industries than for the residentials and apartments. So I think there is a scope. I'm very bullish on this, that they would hopefully give us this 10 crore above, post April as well. That is one thing, that's a take, but we don't want to take the risk. I would suggest, if any of the apartments are, you feel that you are on the verge of, going to go, budget is not a constraint, the decision-making process is a little faster in your apartment complexes, I would strongly recommend to at least get a PPA. If not, you have not selected a vendor or anyone, that's okay. I mean, maybe you can postpone that maybe for 1 or 2 months, but at least you should go ahead and get a power purchase agreement, so that you are safer, if this policy does come into effect. Two things, how does this policy change beyond April, right? If at all it changes, and how is it going to look like? I feel, gross metering, if they implement, they also would allow now is a captive consumption plant. Today, there is no clarity on the captive consumption plants. There has been only a note from the Energy Secretary of Karnataka saying that captive consumption plants could be allowed, but you need to put a wheeling and additional surcharges on that. But there's no clarity on how that wheeling surcharges would be applied. So we are not sure, but that policy clarity is going to come, if at all, post-April. This has been discussed with KERC in the past. They are clear this time that they're going to give some guidelines for apartments or for industries to do a captive consumption. What is a captive consumption? Just to give an explanation, you generate the power right then and there. You use the power in your apartment without exporting any power. That's what captive consumption is. That policy might actually come. And if at all, in a worst case scenario, if government decides, or KERC decides to not to implement net metering about 10 kilowatt even for apartments, there is still a little hope is that captive consumption would be allowed. So most of the apartments who have the STP plans or the WTP swimming pools, those motors actually could be running on solar during the morning time. You may not be able to put, let's say, a 100 kilowatt system on your roof. Maybe that's what you need to make your electricity bill zero. Instead, you might be able to put around 30 kilowatt or 40 kilowatt, at least to take care of these morning time loads. So there is little hope, but my suggestion for all the apartments is to expedite, at least to get to the PPA stage, so that you are on a safer side. Based on the BESCOM's discussion, it's highly likely that BESCOM is not at all interested. But KERC, we need to see how they would look at overall rooftop in Bangalore. And actually, I would like to answer only one other question on someone had asked in the chat about OPEX model. OPEX model, as someone, one of the, I think Prestige Greenwoods has done the OPEX model in the past. The at that time, there was no charges. Now, what they have done for the OPEX model is that they say for first 3 years, you are allowed to do net metering. But post 3 years after you commission the plant, you do need to, they will impose some wheeling and additional surcharges on your tariff rate. And KERC has not defined how much the tariff rate would be. So which is actually very discouraging for any third-party investor to invest in those cases. I have not seen anyone come forward, but I think there's one vendor, I believe, is interested, is, I think, pro OPEX and, some things that actually one could check. But I have not come across myself on OPEX models.
Right now, it's a mixed bag, some positives and some things need to change to for better adaption, I guess. You did mention about PPA. Even if you do, vendor selection takes time, you recommend going for a PPA, right? Can you take us through that process, and what are the lead times which is required, and what does an association need to do it?
Sure. Just to give you a power purchase agreement, to get a power purchase agreement, you need to do an online application. Again, thanks to BAF, this was offline earlier. They are now they made it online. So it's actually simple. You can make an application. I mean, better to do with one of the vendors that you're talking with. Then they have to do a field study. Field study has to be done by the local AW. Once he does that, he gives a technical feasibility report and then gives a letter to you saying that, you know, you can do the PPA, power purchase agreement. And post that, I mean, you can you have a time-based limit also. Again, this was imposed by BAF. You know, this was assertions that they've taken it, where there's a 7-day time period from the time they issue a letter to you to get a PPA, you can go and get the power purchase agreement. So once you have that, then you are through and through. You get 6 months time post that to commission the plant. To get a PPA, in our experience, it will take anywhere from 3 weeks to 4 weeks. Sometimes you do, of course, get in early also, but chances are rare, considering that, you know, the most of the BESCOM officials would be busy going here and there, and, you know, we have seen the delays. But you give at least 1 month time, right? If March 31st is going to be expiring, the current policy, you should at least have, my suggestion is by February 15th, if you make a decision, to at least get a PPA, I think that might actually help you to secure. You know, you have 15 days, and last 15 days, BESCOM, even if it delays you, you're on a safer side.
Thank you, Harsha. My next question is to Sripan Saurav. Sripan, I think Century Saras has gone ahead and done something over and above what other associations do, right? They have gone in for a UL certification. Can you just first tell us about what is this all about? And is it a necessity or an aspiration?
So certainly. The first portion is to understand more about the UL certification. And to understand that, just give you a quick brief, what is UL? UL is basically, the full form is Underwriters Laboratory. We are headquartered at Chicago in Northbrook in US. And here in India, we are based out at Bangalore. So our journey starts somewhere 126 years from now. I mean, it's more than a century old company. And the history is a little interesting. Probably those are the eras where the electric bulb was being invented. That was the time when industrial revolution was happening. And that's where the people started decorating their Christmas tree with the electric bulb. There were the accidents in US where they lost some of the life. And then president, he selected one MIT graduate, Mr. Henry Winrell, and he has been assigned a task to come out with the standards and make sure that the compliance of the product is done so that the safety of a human being is addressed. So that's being the prime concern. We started our journey since then, and our whole motive is to make sure that the world is a safer place for living. We diversified ourselves from then till now, and I represent the renewable groups, which basically we work on certifying and verifying the power plants at a large megawatt scales. And that's where my association is more on to with the ministries in terms of developing the technical guidelines, working out with the IPPs, EPCs who are putting up the big plants, and doing those installations where, you know, that the India renewable targets till now cumulative is somewhere around 35 gigawatt, both rooftop plus the ground mounted put together. The talking about the second portion, which is on the existing Saras apartment where we did it, this is a unique requirement because basically we've been doing these kind of inspections because for the larger plant, because for them the investment stake is too big than the investment done here for the rooftop. And it's from a value matrix as well as from the performance point of a view, they want to make sure that the designs are verified before being operated. So it makes a complete sense. We also want to enter into the space of rooftop, but then we were limited with the kind of approach. We are like B2B company, and probably that reaching out to the individual houses and going for the inspection is a big challenge. I see that the integrators themselves have taken a cognizance of safety in terms of the system as one of the key criteria. And of course, I believe that especially for the apartments, they definitely recognize the safety as one of the key points. So in this particular audit, we have used the standard, which is IEC standards 62446 part one. This is basically to verify a document, and we have performed certain testing for the complete system, which is installed out there to make sure that the correct operation of these grid-connected solar park can be established. So significantly, the audit means that the electrical safety measures were in place at the time of installations. Considering that fire and electrical safeties are normally top concerns for the residential apartment complexes, the audit becomes vital. So we have looked into the electrical aspect. We have verified the designs which has been supplied on the plant, and we have tested those systems for the initial operation if those are fit for operation or not. We also ensure that safety, like in case of emergency shutdown, what kind of mechanism has been adopted, whether the people have easy access to go and shut down the system in case of any casualty happens. We also try to ensure from the safety part of it. So those are the sets of segments which we have given. It is just in a nutshell, just to give you a brief, what is basically a UL certification. It is more on to certifying any product which goes into the market. And probably for a UL certification, you can consider it is equivalent to ISA mark, which we give here in the Indian products. You see the helmets, you see the cylinders, they all hold the ISA mark. Similarly, for the product which need to be sold in US, that mandatorily need to have the UL mark on it. And that's the people preference. That's the citizens' preference out there. They believe their safety is the top most concern than the performance. So that's about the product. But then here we have tried to evaluate the complete system where there were multiple products which were put in together. So we have to make sure that the designs are correct, that they are being implemented into a right way where all the safety consideration has been taken care of.
So at what point do you get involved?
So we've been working with most of the, as I said, that we are working with most of the developers anyhow in the India. I think Solar Square is the company which is associated with this project at Saras. And we've been working with Solar Saras for their bigger scale projects elsewhere. And they also find that relevant because ensuring the safety on the site at the end when it is being installed is a key element. So I think once the installation was done, we were in constant touch with Solar Square. And probably they want, once they approve that, they want to go for the validation once the installation is done. I think that's where we engage with them in this particular project.
Thank you. Shripan, I think the government has set itself a target, a green energy target, right? Do you think changing policies which makes residents rethink on their implementing solar is going to help? How will it impact?
Okay, so probably for that I would like to share my screen and just see if I can share. But I don't. Okay. Let me know if you can see the screen we have recently presented.
Yes, we can see it.
Okay. So this is a bigger picture, and probably I have heard this other speakers were also talking about. But when we are talking about the bigger picture in terms of renewable, there is two slides which I just want to show. So the one is this one. This is the blue lines which you see here is basically the solar, and then we have the wind profile which is yellow on the right hand side. So what you see that solar is peak in terms of the daytime, and then we have a good wind in the night time. But still we see that there are bars, and then you see there is a bar which is basically talking about the demand. So even if we combine solar plus renewable plus wind, we are still seeing there are some bars above the demand, there are some bars which are less than demand. What basically it is trying to say is that we are not able to meet that demand, and that is what is the exact situation right now in the country. It is not because that we are energy deficient country. We have a surplus energy to be produced, but then in the peak demand, which is basically at the beginning of the morning or probably late in the evening, that is the big peak demand. Who is going to meet those peak demand is going to be the question, and that's where the India on a grid level is trying to establish. So this is one picture. There is another picture which I would like to show. So this is the picture of world, one captured in somewhere in 2009, which is on the left side. And then on the right side, this is the picture of the world in terms of power being generated through the different sources. Just in a decade, a lot of things have changed. We see that in 2010 or 2009, we were still producing more with our conventional source of energy. And in 2019 or till 2020, we have seen there is a sudden shift in the complete scenario. And that's where we are seeing that as a bigger level, especially like some of the speaker touched the points on the PPA agreements, and then a tussle between the BESCOMs. Yeah, the situation is right. From their end, they are true as well. But then we are also right now are not on the top of, although we do have a lot of invention which has happened right now in the market. And that's where we are sitting on the tip of the iceberg, where that that complete change is going to happen. And that's where storage is going to play a big role. We talk about that we can utilize those energy for captive use. I think for captive use, no, you don't need to go to sign any PPA. That's at least from my understanding. But then even let's go for that model. We end up in utilizing or feeding that power back to the grid. So it is going to have a mix of both solar plus the grid, which ideally means in the daytime you are substantially reduce the consumption of electricity as a whole. Suppose you have a surplus power, you can then primarily store it into the storage, and that's where the storage is coming in place, where basically you can utilize those power back when required, like if you want to run your motors or your lift or your ancillary powers which you want to utilize for your complete segment. So those are the bigger picture which eventually has to happen, because we are seeing that on one end the cost of producing electricity through the coal or through the conventional way is getting more and more expensive. One of the speaker has shown that year on year 3%, if you see, it is going to rise, by the way. And the only way to bring a notable impact is by trying to be self-sustainable. And for the Bangalore, especially for the situation where we are in, I think with the adoption of these technologies into the apartment and residential building is going to be the first step into that segment. Although it has not gone to that level, but why I have showed you this picture is because the world is changing. We are talking about a big change. We used to have the motorized vehicle right now on the combustible, but we are suddenly talking about e-vehicles. We are talking about Tesla coming into Bangalore. So there is a disruptive change which is happening, and that is going to show a bigger picture for us. So I hope that answers your question, Sandhya. Yeah.
Thank you, Sripan. Just before a last query for you, is there a future for hybrid systems, especially in a city like Bangalore and for apartment complexes going forward?
My prediction says that by 2023 onwards, definitely all the DG sets in the apartments will see a replacement to a storage system. That will be much more viable solution because then they will also end up in saving many other caches in terms they might be paying right now in terms of running the genset. So there will be a disruptive change. And combining that with the solar is the best hybrid example which we can give for the Bangalore right now. I can't propose to go for a wind plus solar plus storage. No, for Bangalore, if we are talking solar plus storage as a hybrid is the best pack to go for.
Thank you. There is, the DG sets, the amount of emissions and the cost which we are incurring is just criminal. So
just to add you, Sandhya.
Please go ahead.
Delhi, actually, they don't allow DG. You know, DG sets are banned in Delhi already today. You know, so you can have natural gas gensets, but you cannot have a DG gensets. DG sets in Delhi, and it's just a matter of time that policy is going to be wider. Available across India as well, including Bangalore. You know, just a matter of time that we are looking in that.
Good to know. Looking forward to it. Next question is to Shankar. Shankar, can you switch on your video and audio, please? Yeah.
Right, okay.
Shankar.
Yeah, ask me.
Yeah, hi. So, it seems the policy comes with a shelf life up to March 31st. It keeps going through changes every year, as I understand. So, BAF has done a lot in simplifying the process so that people can implement it on a larger scale. What do you think will help increase this adaption going forward, specifically given these constant changes?
Okay, I think in the recent weeks, we have been working within ourselves to look at all the issues. Basically, Harsha pointed out many of them, and also Nikhil had talked about it earlier. And so we have these four or five issues that probably if we can find a resolution with BESCOM and KERC, it can help. And as Harsha said, when we had our conversations about a week or 10 days ago with BESCOM, there is as an organization that's doing distribution, they are not very much comfortable if their revenues are going to be hit. So they have always been skeptical. They have not said much when we spoke to them, but they also made a point that they are having a lot of revenue losses with the onset of the solar systems being put up in all the apartment complexes. So they are looking at it with some kind of skepticism. But for us, we have looked at all the four or five issues that Harsha also brought up. One related to net metering, and Vishnu also alluded to it. about the Gujarat and Telangana models. So we are hoping that we will use all this information, and we are going to make an approach to the regulator KERC sometime next week. We have made some kind of a draft note, which we will share amongst our group in BAF and then take it to KERC. The preliminary feedback that we had from BESCOM is they have not had any reservations as far as net metering. They didn't say anything to us. They also spoke about transformers when this was asked for of them last week. They said they don't have a problem as far as transformers not being there up to 500 kWp. And they're also looking at very eagerly at what Gujarat has said and what Telangana has said. And they said that whenever they are looking at it, they are passing some advice to KERC. So what we have in hand are these three or four issues. One, talk to KERC on the net metering to see whether they can follow the models that other states are making. After all, for us also, no, we have been telling BESCOM that they have been the great support or encouraging entity that took us forward on bringing in solar. They were on the people who are trying to push ahead in apartments the solar concept. So we are looking forward to their own support, because they can't let us down in continuing this initiative to promote solar in the apartment complexes. Because after all, for a target that they set for themselves as far as conversion or use of solar is concerned, apartments offer the best option or a great potential. So this is something they have understood, and they are generally, I mean, they have not been very negative when we have been talking to us, but we hope that they will support on two or three issues that are of importance to us. As far as KERC is concerned, there is something that Harsha also mentioned on both this OPEX model, this cross-subsidy charges. So this is something that we also want to raise it with KERC. And on the captive power plants also, we have made a note that we should be talking to them and finding out how best they can support and make sure that we are able to get more of those captive setups also in place. So the wheeling and, banking systems that has been talked about. No, this has been in the probably January 20 meeting that was held at Energy Secretary's office. There has been no clarity on this. So this is something Vishnu is also mentioning. So we have put four or five points for us to pursue with them. Our intention is to make sure that from our side, we don't let go any opportunity to get our issues heard and right resolutions brought for us. So we are still keeping our fingers crossed. But generally, as everybody has been alluding, for most of these distribution companies, solar is a major disadvantage, and all of them are looking to find ways to recover whatever investment costs have been there, either on the distribution side or even on the power generation side. So I think we also need to look at it from a government viewpoint, whether the regulator himself is going to say much, I do not know which way he is going to look at it. But we were told that KERC by and large has to decide the way forward as far as these regulations are concerned. So we are hoping that we'll also have a chance to discuss with the Energy Secretary something hopefully next week. We have other issues that we have brought up to the Energy Secretary. We want to add this to them and then go back and talk to them. So all in all, we will make sure that all the points that have come up, we will try to present to the regulator next week and see what kind of a response we get. Our intention is to make sure that our voices are heard well, and we'll also try to take support from the Energy Secretary if required. But although we are told that KERC does not have much of an influence from either the Energy Secretary or BESCOM. So that's the way I would like to summarize, because most speakers have really brought out all the nuances as far as the issue is concerned. For us, it is just to list them and see how we can progress forward.
Thank you, Shankar. I think you're in for the long haul, because this is a continuous process, and good to have an organization which can get into depth and influence policies in the right direction. There are a lot of queries on the chat window, so I'll hand it over to Ekta to take this up.
Yeah, thanks, Sandhya. So I think most of you are asking your questions, and our panelists have been very kind enough to, you know, also respond to them on the chat. But there are some questions which I will ask to all the panelists who are here, and you all, it's open to all. You all can take turns to answer if you like. So the first question which we had on Zoom is that this is the president of Mantri Green's apartment in Malleshwaram, and he asked that they are going in for a 300 kV solar installation in the next 1 week, and they want advice on the most modern and efficient panels, and you know what is the cost per kV they have to expect, and what are the issues with BESCOM that they need to be aware of so they can deal with it. So if any of you would like to take this up to answer. Yeah, Vishnu, please go ahead.
Okay. Yeah, so I would say, it's best to go from a technology point of view. There are many technological options possible. So right now, it's advisable to go with silicon monocrystalline or monoperc. There are some things like bifacial panels, etc. But I think if you're going for silicon monocrystalline panels, it should be good enough. And with, that generates more power at a reduced space. Right. And costing wise, like I mentioned, right? So panel cost, maybe Harsha, you could say the average cost of, like, let's say REC or Vikram or Wari, Indian makes, or, yeah.
Yeah. Thanks, Vishnu. So in terms of panels, you are looking at, if one panel comes at 25 rupees, the REC comes at, let's say, 25 or 26, you look at Indian modules at 4 rupees cheaper than the REC modules in terms of it. But also you can actually look at 2-3 things that you may want to look at is also on the terms of each of these panels. They have different warranties. One of the panels would manufacturers from India might give around 10 years. And there's a company called Axitech from Germany. They give around 15 years. Panasonic is there for 12 years. REC gives around 25 years. REC is just the exception in terms of their warranties. So you may want to look at these things. Again, the budget is again a major factor for many apartments. So you may want to relook at that. Investing now for the future or investing lower now so that you have a faster returns. That will be the question that, apartments have to really look at from the purchase point of view.
I'm just want to add, Sandhya.
Yes,
Satish. Yeah, we have gone for the REC for our project. So the only reason is when you compare the most of the panel manufacturers, whether it's Indian or Chinese or imported, maximum is 15 years. So it means that the 16th years, about 10% or even 5% of the panel goes wrong. We have to replace that cost versus the 25 years REC warranty. If you calculate, I feel investing in a longer period of warranties works out. I think we have a document to do this. That's the only reason we went to REC for the warranty point of view. It makes sense, the cost, if you have money. If you don't have money, as you said, that's 4 rupees or something is more than the other people. But if you see you have a fund, enough fund, 25 year warranty makes sense for REC.
Right. And anything about what are the possible issues which will come in the way while dealing with BESCOM?
See, my experience, I just share, because some of the panelists told about the limitation or the maximum they can take 4 weeks. But it all depends on how you do networking with the local, because ultimately that local AE is only an important person to get it, not anybody above him. So you have, as an apartment, regular in touch with the local AEE, not only for solar, for anything else, because you have a lot of issues, shutdown, power cut. So you have already a relationship built there. So in our case, actually, we applied on 30th January last year, and we got it on February 5th. It means almost 6 days in paper. and it's online, so you can download the approvals once you apply. And since you know the officer who's going to approve it, and it'll be faster. So I know there are a lot of cases, a bigger apartment, maybe you would have gone 4 weeks. But my experience in Yelahanka, at least I got it within a week.
Okay, yeah. Thanks, Satish, Vishnu, and Harsha for answering these.
Quickly add a point as well. There's a good, I mean, very nice, white paper which Vishnu has co-authored, which is on the BAF knowledge base. I think for quick technical and commercial clarifications and details, that document, it's published last January. I do believe most of the inputs which it has is fairly relevant even now. It's called Rooftop Solar Technical and Commercial Inputs. So I think all the members, BAF members who have any clarifications on those aspects, sincerely request, please go and check that out first. I think it will answer many, many questions that you already have.
Thanks, Vikram. The next question is that one of the participants asks is that, is this the right time, or is the project in the future, like the project cost will come down most likely in the future. So when is the right time to go and, start planning and implementing a project like this, keeping in mind the costs, or should they wait for some more time and wait for the
cost? I would, I'd like to answer that, Ekta, Vishnu here. So. Yeah, so I mean, there is never a good time, right? So it's like if I have to do a startup of a company, right? So is this the right time? Of course, I mean, government is evolving in their policies. They have announced some 1,000 crore seed capital fund now. Things are always evolving. So see, there are always people who look at the opportunities and threats and take a decision right now or right away, or just be early adopters or do things in the right way. But what I saw in most apartment cases is, They go by analysis, paralysis by analysis, right? So they analyze, they talk for hours together. I've seen many apartments who talk like tens of times with the vendors and they don't take any decision. From a policy point of view, that's what we are seeing right now. We have the, I have low bandwidth, that's why I have turned off my video. So I would say from a policy point of view, it's the right time, as Harsha mentioned, before March 31st, get the PPA done and take your 6 months to go for the installations, right? In future, if ESCOMs feel threatened, if they reduce the export tariff for the exported units, or many other things can happen. So we never know how the policy changes, right? So I would say go for it now. Yeah.
I just want to add here, supporting Vishnu. This is one point I learned from this process is that there was a subsidy scheme was there in last January or so. And if I would have waited for the subsidy to come and delay the implementation, I would have lost now 3 lakhs. So it means that anybody you are delaying it, you are already losing money, because whatever you expected to save in implementing this, you are already lost, because some people some of the apartments are waiting for the subsidy to come, and it already, because of pandemic, 1 year you lost, and the one year what you would have saved, maybe you would have recovered by this now if you have decided last year in January. So my experience, we are able to finalize it, not waiting for a subsidy, going with a higher end spec is the right decision we have taken, because we thought, okay, government, why we should wait for it, where rather whatever decision we can have in our control, so that we can implement faster.
Right, thanks, Satish and Vishnu. The next question is that, I think a few of you have actually responded to it on the chat, but just for the benefit of everybody, can you start with partial implementation and increase over a period of time? So if any of you would like to take that up.
I'll answer that. See, partial implementation, you can actually do that as per the policy is concerned today. The same policy continues even after March 31st. What government says is, what the BESCOM says is, they'll give what a 90% tariff rate than what you have done now. So today, government is paying for the energy you have exported at 3.07 rupees. After 1 year you want to implement it, they will give it at 2.67 rupees, right? That is a policy, but also they say that the policy is not guaranteed. You know, if the new policy comes after 1 year, then that tariff rate or that policy would be applicable for the newly installed system. In that, keeping that in mind and looking at the impending changes in the policy, I would actually suggest you to at least get a power purchase agreement. Let's assume that you want to go for a 150 kilowatt system and you want to do a proof of concept. You see if you can actually get a power purchase agreement for the entire 150 kilowatt, but then you go ahead and implement your 10 kilowatt system and then wait for 3 months or 4 months and then just implement this. I mean, if your decision making process is longer in your apartment complex, I think one way is to really do smaller system and then move on with the other, you know, before you, my suggestion is at least get a PPA done so that you have that luxury to change it. And if policy permits and KRC does give you a chance after March 31st, then that's great. I mean, you can probably postpone your plant implementation for one more year, you know?
Right. Thanks, Harsha. The next question is about captive consumption. So does it allow for, you know, does captive consumption allow for storage and how to go about it?
So captive consumption, there are two types in captive consumption. I think one captive consumption is there's no batteries. You are generating the power using on-grid system like what you have, everyone is talking about. But you don't export any power to the grid at all. I mean, you have to have some devices in place. You need to buy those that actually restricts the export of power to the grid. That is captive consumption where you're still synchronizing your power generation with the grid. So that is allowed as of today, but then the clarity on the policy is not there for that, which is we are hoping that post April, KRC would give some clarity on that. Captive consumption with a battery storage system means you're not synchronizing anything with the grid, but you are just storing all the power in the batteries and using. That is allowed even today. There are no restrictions on that whatsoever.
Right. Thanks. Thanks, Harsha. So now the next set of questions is, you know, for Satish, because a lot of people actually asked, you know, how has Century Cyrus gone about doing what they have done, and especially about this UL certification. So there are a few questions. I'll just ask them, and you can probably respond to them in, you know, together. So one is that, what is the cost of getting the UL certification, and who gets it? You know, the solar vendor, or do you, as an apartment, or something, you know, engage directly with them? That is one question. And the next one is, what was the total cost of the project for Century Cyrus, and how much space has been used on the rooftop at Century Cyrus? So if you could shed some light on this. Of course, we have, you know, Citizen Matters has covered this in a detailed case study that we just published a couple of days back. But for everybody who's here, if Satish, you would like to respond to this, and if anybody wants to add further.
Yeah, it's a good question. I think it's a more, it's got three parts. One about the cost of the projects. See, we went for a high-end specification. So the comparison should be there with that level. So, but I can tell you what we went and what other things. So we went for a high spec of REC Singapore panel, which is 350 watt power. And we also went for a N-phase microinverter. So some panelists talked about the storage system going to come in future and other things. Because this project, whatever PPA we are signing is for 25 years. The product warranty and performance warranty again from REC is 25 years. And we don't know what is going to happen for the newer technology. So what we have taken a conscious decision is that go for the latest, which is microinverter. Which microinverter is a digital device. So tomorrow you can program it. If suppose you don't want the grid, you are not happy with the grid supply, you have a storage system come in place next 5 years down the line, we can program it to the our advantage for the storage system. So that is the reason we went for a micro inverter digital. So these two things put together definitely is the higher spec. So, but still we are able to award the contract for 30 lakhs, around 30 lakhs for a 49.7 kilowatt. Regarding the second question of UL, see, this is one of the reason we want to talk about UL. I think my gentleman Saurabh has spoke about it. Nobody has gone for apartment in the past. See, the discussion went the similar way. See, now tomorrow we want to switch her from the grid to the storage system. what is the safety you are going to do, whether we can do something. See, we never thought of UL that time. We thought of a third party inspection. So then vendor came with a suggestion that, okay, they already doing a UL certification, why don't you go for it? So that is again a cost, what definitely is going to cost. So, okay, I don't want to talk about cost here because the vendor has taken care of it. But what I would say is that we had demanded the vendor saying that this is what must. And when we made the RFP, we said, okay, these are the minimum spec we required for quoting, saying that you require this much spec panel, microinverter, certification, PPA to be signed, all this we have taken care of. So it means that the entire project cost us around 30 lakh rupees, which include UL. I think I covered all the points, right?
Yeah, I would like to add a couple of points. So Vishnu, so thanks Satish. So Satish apartment has like huge rooftop space, right? So if somebody has a space constraint, in our apartment, we have done a completely elevated structure. We have erected a metal structure from 12 feet high on one side to 9 feet high on the other side with an angle, right? So with that, we have complete rooftop terrace available for us because ours is a high rise with a 14 floor apartment, which is in the, you know, commercials in the Whitefield on the main road. We don't have too much space, right? So on the rooftop terrace. So that's what we have done. And typically for 100 kWp, you will need, let's say 7,000 square feet. Roughly, you can calculate that. 1 kWp, you will need 70 square feet, roughly.
Thanks, Satish and Vishnu. The next question is, you know, a little, I think most of the people who are interested in installing a solar plant will be, you know, always wondering. So if probably Harsha can respond to this. So usually, how do we ensure the promise by vendors, you know, in terms of generation of, you know, or output, and to protect our investment? Because the investment is usually huge. And if we can't, you know, generate enough units, then it's going to be a huge loss. So how do we ensure that the vendors, you know, keep to their promise?
Right. Good question. See, one of the things I think, which is why a lot of initial discussions with vendors are choice of equipment is so important, right? Either it's a panels or whether it's a inverters, or it's a mounting structure. Just to give you a broader distribution of the costing, if you take 100 rupees is a cost of a plant, you are literally spending 70 rupees, you know, for the inverters and the panels. If you take 60 rupees approximately for the panels, next 10 rupees you're spending for the inverters. And both of them actually are covered under warranties. And it's important that you choose a right vendor, right technology-wise, who can support that. The third major component is the mounting structures. So again, you, as an apartment, I think you need to spend time on understanding which mounting structures would work for you. I mean, these three pretty much at 75% of your cost to 80%, you mostly cover the majority of your equipment, which have longer life. Post that, you know, a lot of times, I mean, and these days, a lot more is people are asking for performance-based guarantees. This is something that has come. We have, as a company, we weren't doing performance-based guarantees because PBGs actually come with a cost. You know, there's a cost of capital that you have to take from a bank, but it's a good thing, right? I mean, it's a good thing for the apartments to have that. But only thing that I would say is that to look at that cost of PBG as well. If you have chosen all these three equipments, majorly panels, inverters, and the mounting structure, you are actually good in first sense. Rest of it, you do two things. Again, you know, we weren't doing it. Now we've started really relooking at how we also do as a company. One, of course, performance-based guarantee is something people are offering. Of course, that comes at a cost. Second thing is also cleaning of panels, you know, should it be in the vendor scope or should it be in the scope of the apartments? We are open to it. We have, you know, we're always being open on the maintenance of it. And that's some, of course, that comes at a cost, but apartments are okay to do it. I think that's something that apartments can go for, you know, with the vendor itself to ensure that you have some amount of guarantee on the generation, some amount of cleaning, but of course they all come at a cost. You know, I mean, that's something that one has to keep in mind.
I just want to add here. Yes. See, as an apartment, the management committee keep on changing year after at least 1 year or some 2 years. So the only thing what how we can mitigate the risk is to safeguard this. So for the safeguarding that whether it's a safety, whether it's a performance by back guarantee, whether it's a SLA to be signed for 5 years for maintenance, all these are safeguarding the interest of our apartment. So it is cost is not going to be that much, no, if you think that way. Because see, today you are implementing it. After 1 year, you are not available as a MC. And next MC is a how we are would have, if not mitigate the risk now itself, the next MC or who are going to come the next after 5 years also should be very safe to running this. So that I feel in my point of view, in our case, at least we went for UL for safety. We went for the bank guarantee for the particular year because at least to ensure that at least when we get return of investment till that time it is no it is performing. The third one what we went is again is a benchmark we did saying that okay let us vendor do all the activity till you get ROI. In the sense about 5 years we sign a service level agreement with the installer. Saying that 5 years you have to maintain it, every 15 days you have to do this, every 1 month you have to do this, every 3 months you have to do something. So to ensure that, no, there's a three mitigation risk of three things. One is safety, second thing is the performance, and the third thing of no, the maintaining it, the preventive maintenance, or we call it O&M.
Sure. Thanks, Harsha and Satish. The next question for Sripan. So a lot of people had questions about, you know, the UL certification. So this is more like a question to UL India. So a bunch of questions, I'm clubbing them together. Can apartment associations directly approach UL to undertake certification? And what is the cost of it? And what is the time which is usually taken to complete the UL audit? And is this audit like one time or is it periodic? And besides this, are there any other certifying agencies offering?
Right. So yeah. So typically depends on the size. I think yes. The first answer would be yes. We would love to. And since we are based out in Bangalore, I think at least this effort put in terms of working closely with the apartment body and those who are willing to take up those safety. Since we are talking about the electrical safety. I just also want to bring into your notice that fire safety is also equally important. And probably while they are looking the safety, they have to look both and together. So the first answer is yes. We can take up if owner of the apartments want to reach out to us, they can definitely do it. The only thing is that they would end up in, because we'll have a lot of questions and on those technicalities. If they are well versed with that, good. If not, they can connect us with the vendors. So that helps in terms of making the execution much more easier. The last response to that would be that the price varies from the size of the plant. But hardly for a size of, if I'll say the size of 100 kilowatt or a 50 kilowatt plant can be verified in 2 working days. So that's a turnaround time. Sizing based on the specification we can discuss. I'll drop my email ID and mobile number. Those who are interested, they can directly reach out to me and we can work out things. Thank you.
Thanks, Sripan, for clarifying. So the next question is for Vikram or anybody else who would like to take it up. So do we know of any RWAs, any resident welfare associations in Bangalore who have taken more than 3 to 4 PPAs, purchasing power agreements with BESCOM due to more number of energy meters?
Yeah, I would like to take that. So yeah, it is very much possible, Ikta. So there, if an apartment has, there are apartments who have 7 meters, 10 meters, 15 meters, right? You do a PPA for each meter. So for example, in our case, we had 2 meters, we do 2 PPAs. So it's very much possible. So you can only, no one is trying to do an aggregation of loads into one single meter nowadays. So if they have multiple meters, they're taking for it, because there is a kind of a slight loophole that I can say, if they say 10 kWp or 50 kWp per meter, let's say, you have 7 meters, you can take 7 PPAs for, let's say, up to 50 kWp in this current situation. Vikram, over to you. Yeah, you can answer.
No, I don't have any further inputs. Comprehensive.
Okay.
No, this is the only way, I think, that the PPAs are signed based on the meter. So I think there's no other option for us. If you are going for more meters for the this thing, you have to have that much number of PPAs.
Right, thanks for that. So since we have, you know, we're running out of time, this is the last question we'll take. But all of you can always like get in touch and we'll try to compile them and answer them later. So this is for Vishnu and Satish, and if anybody else wants to also add to their experience. So what is the effort of the managing committee, you know, which goes into this, and how much time and how much focus must one, you know, dedicate to it? So Vikram, do you want to go Vishnu, do you want to go first and then Satish maybe?
I would just simply say, like Vikram said, do not try to reinvent the wheel, right? So, I mean, when we went, I'm sure that'll be the same journey with Satish, or maybe Nikhil would have struggled because they were the first apartment. So what we have done is we formed a small subcommittee outside MC, like 3-4 enthusiastic people. So they did a simple study. So they got in touch with, let's say, SolarEdge or whoever, Enphase, whoever are the inverter companies about the generation of other apartments. And you go and visit a couple of sites and get a feedback, go through BF knowledge base document, get an experience, and then get going. But what I see most apartment cases, they do so much analysis that they're paralyzed, they're stuck. That's what I see in reality here.
I'll just add to that, I think to put a slightly different metaphor, right? I mean, a big battle has been fought and a lot of blood shed by people like Nikhil. So it's, I think, simpler now to not spend much of time and do analysis, paralysis, like how Vishnu has said. A lot of information is absolutely cookie cutter and available. The return on investment metrics is clean. At least currently the policy and the process is fast. So I don't think so. Committees should get into too much of analysis. There is not too much new to discover, or there is not any piece of significant risk which has not yet been covered, right? It's only a question of availability of funds, right? I think there might be three categories of apartments, right? One set of apartments who potentially have a corpus, which they've already built for critical installations like this. For them, I think the choice is very simple. If the corpus is sitting in normal financial instruments, it generates much lesser output return than how most of the speakers have, I mean, demonstrated that the IRR is much, much higher, right? So think about it from the point of view of the loss of, it's an opportunity cost loss, right? The more delayed that you do the decision, you're actually losing out on money, right? Rather than waiting for cost to go down or whatever, etc., right? There could be apartments who probably do not have a corpus, but do have the ability to generate that the amount of investment which is required. They should also go for it, right? I mean, I know it requires a quick process requirement from the committee. Many of them go through a general body EGM for approval, etc., because obviously it's a significant amount. But don't reinvent that whole technicalities. There are cookie cutter proposals. In fact, I have had an opportunity to share in our own building the presentation to the EGM that we did, which was very simple, straightforward, and to the point, which can be reused. I think many, many people have done that now, so that doesn't need to be reinvented. Eventually, a good economic argument wins hands down, right? There's no argument to that at all. I think the third category of apartments who might find it tough to generate the cash flow for that, they might have a little bit of trouble, because obviously installations require money to be put together, right? And most of the apartments that we've known on obviously have gone for a CapEx kind of a model, because that is making much, much more sense. So I think at this point of time, I think the time required for management committees to put into to plan, etc., I think is not overwhelming at all. They should not spend too much time as well. I think they should simply use all the resources and the wisdom which is available to quickly move through and bring confidence and build confidence. They should play that role. I think they should be able to be absorb this wisdom very quickly and build confidence in their community to say, hey, we are making a very justified and a good choice.
To add something to this, Vikram, I mean, Sandhya, Ekta.
Yeah, quickly, yes, so like in, yeah. In a minute, if you could, because we're running out of time. So.
I'm Nagaraj Dora, President. Whatever Vikram has said is true. I think we should not lose time. First thing is there were some delays discussed. One of the delays was thrown on BESCOM, which is a variable. It depends upon how Satish has done it within a week and how Nikhil could wait for nearly a couple of months. It depends on that. But the delay, according to me, is more on the management side than on the BESCOM side. As Vikram put it, generation of the funds, availability of the, I mean, utilization of the existing corpus fund is one of the best thing to be done. The better thing, there are quite a number of apartments, you know, the committee members available here. You can invite one of the success storied apartment to come to your AGM and make a presentation. Today, the human behavior is, let me look at it, somebody else doing it better, then follow it up. This can be followed up. Actually, some of the delays which were earlier felt, first billing by the BESCOM, and online application were all sorted out by BAF earlier in consultation with the then MD, Madam Shikha. And then they have been a little streamlined now. There could be some delays. Limitation of the manual intervention is the first thing to avoid delay. However, I would request appeal to all the members of the managing committee to have this special general body invite some people who are on the panel. May not be a vendor, but somebody else who has implemented it to know something more about it, because everybody has the same series of questions whenever we go to some apartment. So I would appeal to them to see that PPA is done. One advantage of PPA is, with the moment you do it, the tariff revision may not, you know, happen too frequently to the apartments. That's all my concern. So I would like to second all the people, you know, who have done so well, and thank you very much.
Over. Thank you, Nagaraj. Thank you. So thank you to all our panelists for taking these questions and answering them elaborately. I'll hand over to Sandhya now.
Thank you, Ekta. Thank you to all our panelists and to all the people who have who are here participating in this event. We have shared some links over here. Please go through them. There is a link if you have any queries. There is a BAF Solar Group Telegram link which is pasted. I will paste it again at the end of this one. Please do join it. You have a whole mix of people over there. You can get all your queries answered on it. And I hope this will help you, you know, hasten your process and go ahead and you know, implement the solar before your 31st expiry of the new policy. Yeah. Thank you all once again for being a part of this discussion. Looking forward to, I'm sure there'll be a lot more queries which come. Probably we'll have another session in a couple of months. Hopefully by then the policies will get even better, if not worse. Let's see. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I add just one point?